It's showtime.
Hey, welcome to Did You Watch Survivor Last Night? This is the only fun Survivor podcast. My name is Jake Shidell. Each week I ask my best friend Thomas Powell if he did indeed watch a certain reality show. Hey, Thomas, how's it going today?
Jake, I'm doing super great. It's another Marquesas Monday. I wish it was Sunday. Whoa, that's my fun day. Very excited. Weather's nice out. We have a new season of Survivor to talk about.
We do have a new season of Survivor to talk about. I am very excited to finally talk about a new season of Survivor. And this one was 2 hours long. Did you notice?
Yeah, it was like having two episodes. That's what I kept thinking. Every single minute of the second hour.
I take it you did, but I must ask, did you watch Survivor 46 last night? Source from Spill, I don't do bummies. I serve so much shots in town, the neighbors
think I'm Andy Murray. And I all this food in my tummy. Jake, I'm glad you asked.
I did. What is the Trust No One? Did you watch Survivor 46 Trust No One last night?
I did watch Survivor 46 Trust No One.
Bad title. Come up with a new theme, Jeff. The episode starts with a monologue from Tevin. How did you feel about this?
I liked the Tevin part of the Tevin monologue. I did not like the packaging of it. Like, I don't want to have, like, an epic start to Survivor, you know? Like, well, I don't want to have an epic This Is Cinema intro. I want, like, Jeff being like, we're on board a ship heading over here on Survivor. Like, that's the kind of thing that I want.
God, Thomas, you really should be a writer on Survivor in the future, because that was perfect. That hooked me. I was like, I got to watch what happens in this season.
Yeah, I want there to be, like, immediate momentum. I don't want it to be like I'm watching a bad movie trailer, which, like, and again, not like Tevin did great. Like, I was like, who's this professional that they got to do this voiceover? And then I saw it was Tevin and I was like, oh, nice.
Yeah. I was just going to say something about Jeff Probst, but I forgot. So moving on. Banu applied to Survivor the moment he became a U.S. citizen. And then he says, from Slumdog to Survivor, baby. I feel like he didn't need to say that. You know? I
don't want to police what people are saying. He's allowed to say what he wants. You know what I'm going to say? This is not my place to say whether he should say that or not. I'm going to mind my own business here.
All right. Jess is socially awkward and competitive because she's a twin. How about that, huh? She could be like Charlie Sheen, twinning. Do you like Jess?
Okay.
Mixed
feelings about Jess after this episode.
Tell me about this. What are your mixed feelings?
I don't know. I don't know that she's playing a great game to start. Hopefully this is an Emily situation where she, like, pulls out of a tailspin.
Yeah.
But I think that all of these tech people think that they're way smarter than they are.
Yeah, because they were called nerds throughout school, so that makes them think they're smart. Not every nerd is smart. Here's looking at me. Hunter is not a Taylor Swift fan, but Charlie is. He says he takes the Swiftie bus to Harvard University. What does that mean?
I don't know, man. I just, like, you just got to take it down a notch. I'm sorry. I saw that he was doing some cool charity stuff with his viewing party for the first episode. So, like, that's good. I support that.
Oh, my God.
I just can't get over how fucking annoying he is about that. I'm sorry. That's not, some people really like stuff that I don't like. And I feel the same way about it that I would if he was, like, only talking about Harry Potter or something like that. Like, it just is, I'm sorry. It's just going to bug me.
One thing you notoriously love, but if he's going with this energy, you're like, no, thank you, Charlie. I think Charlie's fine. I don't have any issue with him.
I think
he'll
be a good player.
Yeah, I agree. I like Hunter too. He seems
I love nice. Hunter.
Yeah.
Well, you know who else loves Hunter? Everybody else.
Yeah. He seems quite popular. Maybe he's the David Wright of this season, where he's like an introvert, but then everybody loves him and he makes it all the way to the end, but then is loses.
I mean, he could be Keith with strategy. It's going to be very interesting to see.
Speaking of universities, Tiffany is a self-taught artist who learned from YouTube University. Why to you? What do you think? What are your thoughts on YouTube University?
I have no thoughts on YTU, but I like Tiffany's art. I think it kind of looks like a lot of I've been listening to the MGMT album Congratulations, and it kind of looks like that album cover, but without a cat surfing.
Yeah, Tiffany, draw more cat surfing, please.
I mean, I think that you could have a very lucrative career making album covers for like psychedelic rock bands. So look into that.
Yeah. This is a segment called Music Minute. Music make you lose control. Music make you lose control. Holy shit. We haven't done Music Minute in such a long time.
Oh, wow.
What are your thoughts on the new MGMT album?
Oh, I like it. It's good. I think it's kind of a grower.
Okay.
But I think that I like the way that it's divided into two halves. The first half is a little like more immediate and kind of poppy. And then the second half of it is a little more like experimental. And I really like the last few songs. I would say my favorite songs on the album are, I really like I Wish I Was Joking. I like all the singles. Like I think Mother Nature, Bubblegum Dog, and Nothing to Declare are all pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
And then I like Loss of Life quite a bit. The only ones I'm not super high on are, I guess Dancing in Babylon was also a single. I don't love that. People in the Streets is just okay.
I gave it a listen, but only the one. Loss of Life is the new one, right? Yes.
Yes.
I do like that it starts with Loss of Life Part 2. Very funny bit, MGMT. People in the Streets, Bubblegum Dog. I like Nothing Changes. And then Loss of Life, the last song I also liked. I like that you say it's a grower, though, because it didn't catch me the same way most of their stuff has in the past. So I'll give it another listen. But I think there's still a decent amount of songs on there. Like, what about the new Vampire Weekend? Did you give that a listen?
Aren't there just singles?
Have you listened to the singles yet?
Yeah, I thought they were fine. I think Vampire Weekend's one of those bands that I've never been like. I remember being very in on their first album. But even like, I like Modern Vampires. Like, I like their second album okay. I thought the most recent one was fine. But I don't like them on the same level as some other bands that are their contemporaries.
I really liked their last album, The Wedding on a Weekend or whatever it was called.
Yeah, I thought it was good.
I thought it was a really pretty album, but also kind of sad sometimes. Can you believe that music can do that?
That's crazy.
Anyway, this has been the Music Minute, the world's greatest segment. So,
the new Real Estate album is good also.
Okay. That's not an official recommendation from Did You Watch Survivor last night?
It is an official recommendation. Listen to Daniel by Real Estate. It's good.
Thomas loves his Midwest emo.
Real Estate is not emo. That's Sunny Day Real Estate. Real Estate is like guitar tones indie rock.
Thomas loves his guitar tones indie rock.
I do, and I won't apologize for it.
If you love guitar tones indie rock so much, why don't you marry it? Since you already said I do. Could. Yeah. Okay. Let's talk about Soda. She's here to prove herself to herself. Love Soda. Soda's the best person who's ever been on the show.
Jake.
Yeah.
You're not going to be surprised to hear this.
Yeah. Well, tell me.
I like Soda just fine. The Sodar thing. Can't be doing that. Can't be having people doing their own brand shit on here. I'm not for it.
Wow. What? Okay. Well, we'll get it's to
contrived. Sorry, I don't want people playing up for the camera. I want people to stop being nice and start being real.
That's a different show, and you canceled that segment, too. I guess the show officially has been canceled, but Real World Roundup, RIP. That's what it's called now. Soda's here to prove herself. Q is very competitive also. Guess what? This year, we have 3 tribes of 6. Have they ever done this before?
No, I don't think so. There's just no precedent for that.
This is a new and interesting and compelling. Apparently, a lot of people vomited on the boat ride to the island. Is that information we needed, Jeff?
I thought only the guitar guy raised his hand. Maybe I missed a couple people that did.
No, it was a good handful of them, I think.
Jeff was just breaking the ice. It's his first time meeting everybody in person.
Get the fuck out of here, Jeffrey. Jeff gives a speech about how somebody doesn't have what it takes to win. Good, funny stuff. I like the correction over last season when he was like, all right, feel free to quit. Here's a vape pen, special Jeff Probst CBS branded.
Yeah, we did. This was a good episode for Jeff to get back into round back into form. And the form is hating quitters.
Yes. Good. Continue. At the reward challenge, quote unquote, they run under. He called it something else, which is why I say, quote unquote, I don't remember. The marooning challenge, I think.
Yeah.
Again, stop trying to make shit happen. It's a reward challenge. It's the first reward challenge, and it's a good one. They have to run under a net through mud, under a beam, collect large puzzle pieces, complete the puzzle, and get Flint from a tall pole.
I feel like that the puzzle was like a platform they had to build to get up so they could take the Flint off.
Yes, I do like that, too. I like when they have to incorporate the puzzle into something they're building for the challenge itself, not just the puzzle. I liked that, too. I didn't like the ending. The grabbing a Flint from a tall pole feels like a anticlimactic ending to this first challenge. There should be some, like, big celebratory thing, and instead you have to, like, run far and then run back to your tribe. Just awkward. Like, smash a
plate of
glass.
No, I liked it. I disagree with you. I thought it was good.
We're disagreeing on the show this season, apparently.
The one thing that I did think would be really funny is if you, like, flung it way too far instead of trying to work it off and it just, like, went into the jungle and you couldn't find it in time to get back with it. That'd be pretty funny if that happened.
Maybe that's what they were hoping for would happen. Or what if you flung it too far and it landed in somebody else's hand on a different tribe and then they take it back to their tribe and they win? That'd be pretty funny.
I think Jeff would probably say that wouldn't count, but I do like the idea of that being legal.
Jeff, let them play, you know?
You gotta let them play.
Okay, so we get our first talking head from the legendary Jelinski. He says, Jeff preaches about the monster in the game. Jelinski is the monster. You were saying earlier about self-branding. It's your favorite thing that people do on this show?
Yeah, I love it. Jelinski needs to decide whether Jelinski is, like, a character or not.
What do you mean by that?
Because Jelinski kept backing down every time that Jelinski looks like he's going to be like a brash player or whatever. He immediately is like, no, I'm actually not like that. I can't lie. Like that guy, like, it's just like, yeah, he's just not, he won't commit to anything.
Yeah. You got to lean into that. If you're going to come out there calling yourself by your last name unprompted, what is this? Me talking about the Masked Singer. There it goes again. Q and Jelinski do the sweat challenge. We'll talk more about that later. Banu is super excited to be in Fiji. He says he grew up in a similar setting in India and calls himself the provider. Are you liking Banu yet?
I he's a bit much, but like he seems like a nice dude. And I think he's, you know, definitely a real asset to your tribe in the early game. And I'm interested to see how his game evolves.
I like him. I'm excited to see what happens with him. Excuse me. Sorry. I'm pulling up Lostopedia right now because over on the Siga tribe.
Looking to see if they have any Cerveza Crystal up there.
We have Ben and Charlie doing the Savvy Challenge. Remember from Lost, Ben and Charlie?
Oh, Ben and Charlie, of course.
Yes. They worked together rarely. They kind of were not friends ever. But they are friends on this show. They do the Savvy Challenge but fail, and then they call themselves the Dumb and Dumber Alliance. Pretty good stuff. Do you like Ben?
Yeah, I thought that was fun. I'm liking some of the early alliance stuff that we're getting here, because there's another alliance that I think everybody's going to be a big fan of that we'll get to.
I can't wait. Tim and Maria bond over being parents. Oh, is that the one you were talking about? The Parents Are Us
alliance? I'm not talking about Parents Are Us.
Mm-hmm.
This one got an explicit name.
Yeah. I think I know the one you're talking about. Nami, Hunter, and Tevin bond over Andy Griffith. Is this the one you were talking about?
Yes, the Andy Griffith Alliance, right down to the little video package that we got. I'm huge on the Andy Griffith Alliance. I think they have potential to really... We could be seeing the Andy Griffith Alliance at Final Tribal. I'm just going to throw that out there right now.
Ooh, wow. Thomas, you don't big often come out with these guys.
I'm very in on... We were both saying we like Hunter. We're both in on Hunter. I'm very in on Tevin.
I like Hunter, and I like Tevin, and I like Andy Griffith as well. Although I don't know that I've ever actually watched the Andy Griffith show. Have you ever watched an episode?
I watched a lot of Andy Griffith as a kid.
Yeah. That's the biggest difference in our lives. You watched
Andy Griffith, and I did not. Yeah, you're not a Don Knotts appreciator like me.
Unfortunately, I'm all about Cheers, baby. Love that shit. That's my sitcom from back in the day that I grew up on loving.
Interesting that you like Cheers, but from what I can tell, you don't watch Frasier. Fake fan.
Yeah, because I'm more interested in the original cast of Cheers. I'm all about Diane.
Well, if you knew anything
over...
about Frasier, you would know that they almost all show up in guest spots on Frasier.
I
so
did
who looks
know
stupid
that.
Now? It's
I
you.
Did know that, actually. But Frasier didn't come in until like season 3 or 4. And they didn't even need him. They were doing just fine all on their
How
own.
How dare you?
Coach, Norm, the postal worker whose name I'm forgetting right now, Cliff. Sam, Diane,
Cliff is
Carla.
So important to the show that you couldn't remember his name.
I think more of him as the postal worker than his name, Cliff Clavin, which is unfortunate because it's a great name.
Yeah,
perfect
Cliff, yeah,
show.
One of the most memorable names in the history of sitcoms. And you were like,
Once Frasier
like if you
got
were like
in,
Jerry's ugh. Friend that always comes in weird from across the hall. What's his name?
I don't think we all remember his name and don't need to repeat it. We love Cheers. Do you want to do a Cheers show?
No.
God damn it. Do you want to do a Frasier show?
Yes.
This is how we'll do it.
You know what it would be called? It would be called Did You Toss Salads and Scrambled Eggs Last Night?
That's what it would be called, yeah. Here's my pitch. You watch an episode of Frasier. No, here's the better pitch. I watch an episode of Frasier. You watch an episode of Frasier.
This is what I was pitching, but sure.
I watch an episode of Frasier. You watch
I've
an episode
I've watched
of-
Cheers, okay? You're the one that hasn't watched stuff.
I've watched stuff, okay? I'm like halfway through Mrs. Davis, and it's really good, actually. I've watched All Lost several times, and as we all know, several
means
seven.
I bet you haven't even watched Shogun yet.
I haven't watched Shogun yet. I don't know why I had to yell that, but I've heard it's quite good, and I want to check it out.
It is very good. You should watch it.
Okay, that was TV Tenet. Another segment.
It's got Ricardo's Albert in it.
Ooh,
he's doing a
him.
Nice Spanish accent.
That's great. What is this, a flashback episode of Lost? Okay, well, let's talk more about the Sega Alliance. Liz, was there a Liz on Lost?
No, I don't think so.
I think you're wrong.
There was Elizabeth, right?
There was Elizabeth Sarnoff, who is a writer on Lost. Okay, never mind, you guys. There's no Liz on Lost. I'm so sorry. I thought I had something here.
Interesting.
I thought this could be like the Lost Tribe or something, but apparently not. Anyway, Liz says she helps people write emails and also owns and has sold multiple business, which bothers Tevin. You seemed to be really high on Liz before we started, right?
No. And I think Liz was right about in line with what I expected.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she seemed to be exactly the person I expected her to be. Soda makes fire super easily. Do you think she'll go to the fire-making challenge at Final Four?
They better not let her get there. I mean, it's smart to practice fire for camp reasons, especially for this one, and for later game reasons, but I wish that it was less an expected thing.
Yeah.
We've talked about this at length.
We then go back over to the Yanu tribe. Q and Jelinski have a hard time, and Jelinski quits and tosses the hourglass, which obviously bothers Q, who is competitive. This was funny. I mean, it wasn't funny. It was annoying that Jelinski did that. But it was very funny that they did a close-up of the hourglass being smashed. But like, look,
yeah,
folks.
Yeah, that was pretty funny.
We're 5 seasons late, but sorry about the hourglass twist. That's what it said to me. For those eagle-eyed
no
viewers.
No more of this.
Yeah. Over on Sega, Charlie and Ben from Lost apologize for losing. Huh? Lost? But everybody is cool about it. Just like everybody on Lost was cool to Ben, eventually. Do you think Charlie will ever say, not Penny's boat?
Oh, it would be so nice, but instead I'll probably say some Taylor Swift shit that I don't care about.
I'm feeling 22. Okay, everybody likes Ben.
You know if there were 22 contestants, he would be saying something about that.
God. Yes, one more try with only 4 people on it. Or 2 tribes of 11 people. That's something you've never done, Jeff. Do more episodes, get more sponsors, think about it. And then get Charlie back on so he could do Taylor Swift songs all the time. Anyway, everybody likes Ben. Ben the musician. Everybody likes Ben. Do you like Ben?
I mean, I think he seems like he's more of a people person than, like, he's connecting to his audience more than Sifu did, as far as I can tell.
I think that's a good call. Mariah and Jem bond over meeting their partners at a bar. This was nice. You were talking about, what are they called, viewing parties earlier, and it made me realize, oh, I bet Jem's having a viewing party here in Chicago, Illinois, where we both live. Exciting stuff, isn't it?
Yeah. Did you find that out, or?
No, I forgot that those happen. But it's a long season, you know, and Jem's going to be on the show for a long time, I'm sure. Fingers crossed. But Mariah is awkward. She loves board games like D&D. Is Mariah the new Emily?
I don't know. Maybe. I don't know.
Is Mariah the new Aubrey?
I don't like people like explicitly comparing themselves to other players. It bugs me.
But I'm not the player.
But, like, wasn't she the one that was like, I watch Cochran play, and he told me it was okay to be weird.
Yeah, I forgot about
that. And I think
she
explicitly mentioned Aubrey in, I don't know, she seems fine.
The audience loves a nerd.
One tough nerd.
I'm pretty sure you've referenced that every time.
The Rick Snyder thing?
Yeah, I was trying to remember his name. Great tagline.
One tough nerd.
It's better than the Biden's apparent one this year. Biden by default. Cool. Cool thing to say. Way to encourage your base. Anyanu Banu. Do you think that's why they put it on that tribe? Because his name runs with the tribe name? He starts calling Q Coach while they try to open coconuts. Coach Canuts.
Good one.
Right from Cheers, Coach.
Yes, of course.
When he made a pina colada.
Him and that postal worker.
The postal worker would always come in ordering a pina colada, and he would be like, oh, do you mean a Coach Canut? It's a good show.
That's it. How good? How great?
So good. Okay. Kenzie says, who needs the sweat challenge when you have beautiful people? And then reminds us that she's in the beauty industry, so she knows what she's talking about. Well, how did you feel about Kenzie in this moment?
Kenzie's the one. I don't know. I mean, people seem to really like her.
According to her, though.
Get that, but at the same time, you can see that she, like, immediately built a bunch of relationships with everybody on that tribe and is, like, in the driver's seat.
I don't think we've heard as many people say, oh, I love Kenzie so much the way they do about Hunter. You know? I don't know. We'll see. I don't know. Everybody seems to like Kenzie according to Kenzie, but just doesn't want to talk about strategy. This is what keeps happening on the Traders, too. People are like, give me a name. And they're like, oh, I don't know. Oh, I don't want to upset anybody. I'm just
scared to compete.
Yep. We need a new strategy. We need a new competition show called Scared to Compete, and it's all people like this who are scared to make a move, and then they're forced to make a move. Maybe it could be a simulated season of Survivor we do. Scaredy cats versus other scaredy cats. Jelinski could be on there. Jess. Others. Okay, Soda leads a group song on the Nami Beach, which annoys Hunter. Hunter and Tevin.
I also don't like group songs, but you know what? He was very polite about it.
Yeah, I figured you would agree with Hunter in this scenario. Hunter and Tevin seem to have a solid relationship. He asks Tevin to help him learn to sing while they build the shelter. This was nice. Great relationship. Oh, yeah, and then this is where we get the little black and white video package with the song.
Yeah, I was worried that what was going to happen was that because Hunter was, like, more introverted, that he was just going to get, like, a truck run over him by the rest of this tribe. They're going to be like, he just doesn't fit in. But actually, everyone loves him, and everyone seems to get along well. So yeah. I thought this was nice.
I agree. On Sega, they talk about music. Two great recommendations from the cast of Survivor 46, Trust No One. Kanye West and Taylor Swift, remember the greatest feud of our generation?
It feels like it was a million years ago.
It was. That was like 2009, which, as we all know, was 1 million years ago. Who does that show feud on FX? Ryan Murphy?
It's Ryan Murphy, yeah.
I fully expect them to do a feud, Taylor versus Kanye, in like 10 years.
They probably will.
It's going to be so bad, and it's going to be fucking Jay Pharoah playing Kanye.
It's going to be terrible.
In his first dramatic role, Jay Pharoah, and like the dude from SNL 20 years ago? Okay. Charlie wants to get out of the bubble of Manchester by the Sea. One of the funniest named towns in the country, I think.
Yes.
It's next to Newport News and Hell, Michigan. Like, why did you name your towns this? You could have named them anything.
Trying to think of other good ones like that.
Goochland?
Yeah.
But that's funny in like a middle school kind of way. Manchester by the Sea is funny because it's just convoluted.
Martha's Vineyard is pretty funny. A lot of the New England ones are funny.
Yeah, they were kind of just going all out when they were planting flags out there. Do you plant flags? Like, I play a lot of Civilization, and that's what you do in Civilization when you make a town, so.
It's true.
The girls on this tribe want to pull in Charlie, and they call themselves Charlie's Angels. I like this tribe dynamic. I like this alliance name. But it does feel like we're getting a lot of alliance names very early, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think, again, like a little too much branding. I like some of these alliances, but I think everybody's, I don't know. Can we have some people that like don't look like they are very like, it just didn't feel like everybody was trying to be super polished for television the way that they are now, you know?
I know what you mean. Well, it's probably because everything's in high definition now.
That's true.
Tim catches the women working together and says, I have a wife. I have a grandma. I know how they operate.
It is so funny every season to be the, like, you know what happens when women are on this show.
Yeah.
Like, when was the last actual women's alliance?
I think about 20 seasons ago.
Yeah, like, they always break up. Like, it never actually, like, it happened one time, and people every season are like, it's every year.
Yeah, it happened one time on a notoriously bad cast. On a season that was already divided by gender. Like, you guys don't need to worry about this.
Like that Charlie's reaction to that was not like, good point. He was basically just like, I like that everybody is trying to be in an alliance with me. That's good. I'm just like, he did not agree with him, but he just kind of shined him on enough to be like, well, I can use this later.
Yeah. I love that his list of women ends at two.
Yeah.
Like, there's only two women in your life.
I've observed two women in the wild. And let me tell you. They be talking. Have you seen that movie, Women Talking, that was nominated for an Oscar last year?
I have heard of it.
Then you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, women. Women be talking about alliances. It's such a funny thing to say. I have a wife. I have a grandma. I know how they operate. Like, your wife and your grandma? Are they working against you? I have a husband and
grandson.
I just imagine that, like, Tim goes to family functions and his grandma and wife get together and talk shit about him. Like, that's the only scenario where you can, like...
They're always tearing me down.
They're so... My wife and grandma are so mean to me at Thanksgiving.
You wouldn't believe the shit that they say about me.
On the Nami Beach, Tevin calls Venus a princess and she denies it and goes looking for an advantage. This was good. Venus is good. We love
Venus. Had a talking head in this show that I wish that anyone on the Traitors would ever have.
When
the one where when Randon was on to her, where she was like, "How dare you accuse me of doing this, even though you are absolutely correct and I was doing that? But how dare you suspect me of it?"
That's very funny, yes. Randon does indeed target Venus because she's hot. Like Parvati, remember?
He doesn't target her because he's hot. This is the thing that's crazy to me, is she was like, "Oh, he compared me to Parvati? Well, I'm going to take that as a compliment because she was a really good player." It's like, yeah, that's what he meant.
Yeah.
You were playing strategically.
Yeah, but no, but also because she's hot. She's strategic and hot, which you can't be both. You can't be both because of Parvati. Both.
He was just comparing her to Parvati, who is both.
No, that gets you voted out. Remember Parvati? She won the game her second time. That's the thing.
This is just one of those things where it was just like, it's not like, it was also bizarre to me the way that everybody else in the tribe reacted when he was like, "Yeah, it seems like she's looking for an idol. It seems like she's really like gunning to play. I think you should be careful." And I like that Soda's reaction was like, "I don't like that he noticed that she was playing strategically and came and talked to me about that. That's very suspicious." Oh. Like, what? What the fuck are you talking about?
You mean when her sodar was going off?
Yeah.
I think it's good. Soda immediately tells Venus about it, and then we learn that Liz is allergic to everything.
Okay, look. Why the fuck are you on Survivor?
I was saying, I wish we had gotten a sob story about Liz's allergies.
I appreciated that we didn't get that, but it's like, look, this is like going on, this is... very probably worse than going on while withdrawing from cigarettes, because like you're gonna have to eat food.
Yeah, and you can't even smoke cigarettes. Liz is allergic to cigarettes. Can you believe that? One thing
unbelievable. How's she gonna trade her shirt for that?
She says one thing you gotta know about Liz is you don't have to apologize to Liz.
Said you don't have to apologize to Liz for being who you are.
Yeah.
Look, I like Tevin. Mm-hmm. Don't like Jelinski. Mm-hmm. Not a huge fan of Liz. Too many people referring to themselves in the third person this season. I think you can have one. I wish that it was just Tevin.
Literally, but my next note. Yep. Feels like a lot of people doing that this year. Don't like
you. You have to be as charismatic as Tevin to pull that off.
Yeah. Like, I didn't even notice Tevin was doing it most of the time.
I don't think he's really, has he done it? I don't know if he did it in this episode. He just did, in his promotional video. He said, he's like, was like very excited to get to know Tevin when he was talking about himself.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I know. I remember that. Yeah.
But like, it fits his whole thing.
Yeah. Journey, Jelinski goes for Siga. The dice pick Tevin for Nami, and Maria beats Mariah in rock, paper, scissors. Whatever, who cares? They all go to the journey. When Maria leaves, they all caw to her like seagulls. Very funny. They're doing the same bit we did last week. Remember when we called them the seagull?
It's true, yeah. They also, I'm glad that we can all agree that it's the Seagull Alliance.
Yeah. And the Jelinski says he's here to win and calls himself a legend again. You know, maybe. Maybe if he comes back. I don't know.
If you want to be a legend, you got to play like a legend. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Legendary bitch. No, I'm just kidding, Jelinski. I'm sure you're a nice guy. They play.
Yeah, Jelinski seems nice. Everyone seems to like him. They just are annoyed by him quitting.
Yeah, they play a card game in which someone must lie, but the other one always tells the truth, and then the third one must decide who is lying and who is telling the truth, or something along those lines. Tevin gets the vote card, Jelinski does a bad job lying, and immediately hops to it. Maria tells Jelinski that if he's lying, she's going to have to tell her tribe that he lied. I mean, what was he to do? Oh, that was the other thing. They each get an extra vote if he gets caught lying.
It's just, yeah. I think it's really funny, the idea that, like, your team would be like, you lied to get an advantage in the thing where you need to lie to get an advantage. I can't believe you would do that.
You played the game that you were presented on the journey?
Well, again, we take this as a given, but we are watching The Traitors right now, and there are people that play that game that way.
I can't wait to talk about The Traitors. Let's hurry up. Jeff then yells at us to apply to Survivor. Did it take for you this time? Just say, oh, I will still
not be applying for Survivor.
Then on Yanu, Jelinski tells them the truth about what happened on the journey, and everybody yells at him. Very funny.
I am enjoying how much everyone is, like, getting annoyed by Jelinski.
I wish Jelinski, like,
dude, come on.
I wish Jelinski had stuck around for longer, just so everybody would yell at him every episode.
Yeah, it was compelling.
It's very funny.
I can't lie.
Maria tells them what happened at the journey, and everybody makes fun of Jelinski.
Yep.
Forgot that happened. That's so funny. Then on Yanu, Jess is having trouble sleeping, only recently got her ADHD diagnosis, and loses her water bottle. She's having a hard time, and I feel very bad for her.
Yeah.
But then Tiffany finds a Beware advantage with a lock on it. Can't access it until Yanu loses the immunity challenge. Tiffany says she doesn't have time to be nervous. She says, who has time to be nervous? We're only out here for 26 days. Good luck.
That's a good outlook.
Yeah. I think I like Tiffany too.
Oh, I like Tiffany. Yeah.
I think we may have passed judgment too quickly on this cast, because there's a lot of people I like that I didn't expect to like.
Oh no, I'm into the cast. Yeah. I think, you know, Jelinski is gone.
Yeah.
So I think the most annoying people we have at this point are, I don't know, who would you say?
Kenzie and Banu, maybe?
Yeah, and the lady with all the allergies.
Oh, yeah, Liz, yeah.
Liz.
Liz,
but
not
like,
from
yeah,
Lost.
I don't know. Like, I think, I don't know that, like, Kenzie and Banu are, like, my cup of tea personally. But, like, they're setting up to be good players. I think they'll be compelling to watch. So
yeah,
like,
yeah, absolutely.
And they're not like, you know, it's not like I'm like, these are bad. These are bad people.
Like, oh, is that not what
nice?
You're saying?
I seem like nice people.
Everybody on the show
I'm
seems
just mean.
Like
I'm a mean person.
I thought,
and I'm cynical.
That everybody on the show was just an asshole. That's what I've come to learn about this show. At the immunity challenge, Jelinski is mad that several doesn't mean seven.
This was just like, dude, what the, like, come on, help yourself out here.
I understand his point, because I've always assumed several means about seven as well.
That's not, of course you would side from this.
But at the same time, Jelinski, you know you always have 4 hours on this challenge. They've been doing this challenge for years now. You always get 4 hours on this.
Yeah, that's what it is. It's not that several has never meant seven or anywhere close to seven.
They have to move a big gecko and then do a puzzle. This is very good. This is a good challenge. I think they should use the big gecko in every challenge.
I do. I love the big gecko.
Big gecko in the water, big gecko in a boat, big gecko under, you have to build the big gecko's home.
Yeah, get weird with it.
Yeah, big gecko, we love. I think big gecko is behind this season. Then Jelinski is yelled at by his tribe again when he does the puzzle pad.
He did do the puzzle bad. In his defense, Jess also did the puzzle bad.
In Jess's defense, though, she's apparently not on her ADHD meds and isn't sleeping. So
But the thing is, though, is you can't. This one of my favorite things is when people are like, "I'm gonna crush all the puzzles because I'm smart," and then they just do unbelievably shitty at the puzzles, and they're like, "I'm sorry."
Okay, have you considered that the puzzles are actually hard? Like,
well, yeah, but if your whole thing is like, "I'll be good at puzzles," then you can't be bad at puzzles. That's not allowed.
Can't you? A lot of people have been.
Well, I'm not saying you can't, but you should not be.
You do it then. How are you with puzzles?
I'm not applying. You're not going to trick me into applying for Survivor, Jake.
That's the ultimate goal of this show, is to get you to apply for Survivor.
It's not going to happen.
And then to get you on Survivor. Can you imagine? Okay, so Nami wins. Siga takes second. Banu cries about losing. Banu cries a lot.
Banu does cry a lot.
It's fine. Banu's nice. At Yanu, Jalinski wants to chill in the shelter because he assumes he's good. Love an overconfident king.
We stand.
Tiffany finds the next clue to her idol and solves the cipher and finds her key and unlocks her idol. She says, "Survivor bucket list item achieved." This was cool.
Yeah, it's, you know, I mean, again, I wish people wouldn't talk about the show that way, but this was neat. I did think it was funny to be like, well, like, I wish we hadn't lost the challenge, but actually I don't care that much. I got my idol.
Yeah. I feel like we complain about the idols now every time, but I wish they would look cool again. Like, make it a gold medallion or, you know, some sort of interesting wood art or something. Like, these fucking friendship bracelets. Like, I understand this is the Taylor Swift season, but, like, it looks bad. Like, this fucking plastic beads and shit. Like, what are you doing?
It does look bad.
I understand the point is, oh, so you might be able to make a fake idol. Yeah, you shouldn't be able to make a fake idol. That should be your last, most desperate attempt. Anyway.
The fake idols almost never work either. Like, the idea that that's going to be too much of a factor in the game is kind of ridiculous to me.
Yeah. Q is targeting Jalinski, but Jess is the other target, so Banu doesn't know what to do. I think Banu might make it far. I think Banu might make it to 4 or 5.
I can see it.
And then be cut by his closest ally. He seems like that type of character.
Do you think this is like a tie type game, potentially?
I do see a lot of tie in him, yeah. Jess isn't bringing strength, somebody says, despite being the strongest on the puzzle, and the puzzle is the great equalizer. Did you know?
I did know.
Okay, let's talk about these wildlife shots. We had spiders, we had doves, and we had another visit from your son, Roland the Bat. Thomas, can you give us an update?
Always nice to check in with my boy.
Yeah, what's he up
to? He's there. I mean, what, like, nothing's changed. He's still living where he always lives.
Does he have favorites? Is he eating anything good this year?
He's got fans and favorites, and sometimes they're against each other.
At Tribal Council, Banu mouths along to Jeff, welcoming to Tribal Council spiel. That was hard to say. Jess talks about sleep deprivation. Q tells Jeff about them quitting the sweat challenge. And then Jalinski says he and Q don't give up. And then Jeff calls him out for quitting the challenge. Good stuff, Jeff.
It was great for him to be like, I don't quit on anything. Yeah. It's like, you just quit. He's like, well, accept that.
Yeah. You had two instances where things came to you and you quit both of them. I'm surprised he didn't quit the game. It was a gentleman's quit in that everybody voted for him.
That's true, yeah.
Jess tries to distance herself from Jalinski. And then Jeff asks Banu if he thinks it's Jalinski. And Banu says, after a long pause, it's time to vote. I loved that. I thought that was really funny. Banu's the best. And then, yeah, they vote. All of them go to Jalinski. Jalinski doesn't even get to vote. That's so funny. I know that, like, we go back and forth on the losing your vote thing, but losing your vote,
it's really funny
that,
when you lose your vote and get all the votes.
Yeah. It's like, you shouldn't be literally unanimously voted out, but It happens that now. Okay, so we, of course, started last season, or this season, with 0 points each. You got a point for Maria surviving on the Seagull tribe. I got a point for Jem surviving. You got a point for Jess surviving the Giannis Antetokounmpo tribe.
Yeah, I know. Touch and go for a minute there.
I know. I got a Banu survived, so I got a point for that. And on Nami, you have Hunter. I have Venus, Vafa, and they both survived. So we both now have 3 points. Now that we know these tribes a little bit, who's winning the reward?
I'm going to say the Seagull tribe.
Okay, I can see that. I'm going to say the Nami tribe. I think I like them the most. I think they're my favorite tribe so far. What will this reward be?
I'm going to say that it is... I'll say fishing gear.
Hmm, good call. I will, of course, go with the classic tools to build a shelter.
I almost said it. I'm not going to lie.
Well, they didn't get it this episode, so they must next one. Otherwise, fuck. Like, do they just stop doing that? Who's winning immunity?
I'm going to say Nami wins immunity.
I will say, you know what? He's one of the greatest ballers in all the land. Giannis Antetokounmpo is winning immunity. And finally, who will be voted out? Oh, boy, there's so many people, so...
I'm going to say Tim. I'm saying Tim's getting voted out.
I was going to say the same thing. That line from him, his grandma, his wife, talking shit about him on Thanksgiving. Not a good look, Timothy.
We love women on this show.
We love women.
I think we can all agree.
We love women, whatever they look like. If they're sassy, we especially like them. And if they're Rhea Ripley, we like them even more. Agree or disagree?
Agree.
Thomas, there's been a lot of talk about parenting on this episode of Survivor. So can you tell us the name of this week's quotes quiz? So nasty that it's probably somewhat of a
travesty having me. Then he told the people you can call me your majesty. This parenting test run quiz will determine where you land on the helicopter relaxed parent scale.
What's that mean? What's a run quiz?
Test run quiz.
Oh, this parenting test.
Parenting test run quiz.
Parenting test run quiz. Okay. Man. Okay. Oh, September 11th, 2023. Never forget. You think you know the answer. This is from Jerry's team, who's a little fox. He has 260 points. All right, first question. Let's start out with the basics. What's for dinner? Anything fast. And it's a burger. Steak. Duh. And steak. Something balanced, and it's like chickpeas and a slice of pizza and some tomatoes and yogurt.
I believe that's non-bread.
But that makes a lot more sense given what else is in this plate. Yeah. Whatever is in the fridge. Ooh, that last one is tempting. That last one's
whatever's
tempting.
In the fridge, baby. Let's go.
I'm going to go with something balanced, obviously, after I tell you last night, again, don't have kids, so I don't feel bad about this. Got some Popeyes. Oh, got Popeyes chicken sandwich. Oh, so good. Mashed potatoes, mac and cheese. This is a free ad for Popeyes. Okay, Thomas.
I do love Popeyes.
You're picking up your kids.
If they want to sponsor us, I will take it.
Yeah. You're picking up your kids from school. How early are you showing up? 15, 20 minutes. 15 minutes, 20 minutes, right on time. They're taking the bus. Is this a real question?
They're taking the bus,
They're
obviously.
Taking the bus? What the fuck? The bus is provided by the school. Or whatever. I'm not going to waste gasoline on a fucking child. When are your kids allowed to date? Whenever they fucking want. It's none of my business at 14 years old, at 16 years old, 18 years old. I feel like it's none of my business, right?
Yeah, I think I'm with you on that one.
I always felt weird, like, in middle school or high school when... kids would be like, oh yeah, I'm not allowed to date. Like friends would be like, oh, I'm not allowed to date until I'm 16. Like, who's telling
you
that?
Let middle schoolers have their fake relationships. Well, who am I to tell them it's not real?
Right? Like, just don't tell your parents you held a boy's hand in math class. It's fine. Movie night. When can your kids watch an R-rated movie? I would guess whenever the show times are, right? It's 17 years old. It's a law for a reason. Around 14, I don't care any time, but with a parent.
I would say the fusion, for me, it would be like probably before they're 14, I'd want them to watch it with me, but then afterwards, I don't care. So I'll just say around 14 years old, just to, because I do have some conditions on the anytime.
What are your conditions?
Oh, it's just going to be that before that, I'd have to, I would be making executive decisions before that. What? And also, if they watch it behind my back, that's fine.
What R-rated movie?
Because that's an important part of being a child.
What R-rated movie are you showing your child?
It just depends. They can watch, like, Aliens with me if they want.
Oh, I thought you were saying the diapers commercials. Yeah, Alien, great flick. Predator, is that R? I guess a child
would probably... They can definitely watch Predator with me.
I don't know if a child would really appreciate Predator. Before Sunrise. I'm going to show that to my 9-year-old son. I'm going to show my child, like, it's 51st Dates Before Sunrise at 7 a.m. every morning. And then at 8:30 when the movie's over, my son will rise from bed.
My kids can watch as many R-rated movies as they want as long as they're Richard Linklater movies. Yeah. The only R-rated ones you get.
That's fair. When will your kids get a phone? Wow, good question. In the 5th grade, in the 7th grade, in high school, as soon as they need one. Are you going to have an iPad, baby? Not
till high school. Fuck you.
Yeah, high school is the way to do it. That's when I got a phone.
You don't need one before that. Yeah.
My parents were like, you can have a phone when you have your driver's license. I was like, all right, fine. Fair enough. So then I had to fucking learn to drive. Can you believe that?
Will you learn how to use AOL Instant Messenger. Bring it back.
Can you imagine? What does that mean? Will you cuss in front of your kids? Yes, it's just words. No, I want to teach them how to use proper vocabulary. Only when necessary. I can, but they need to learn how to be respectful with their words.
I'd say probably the last one. I think it would basically be like, I will get less and less strict about it. I will become more lax in it as they get older. I feel like that's the way that you do it as a parent, that you have to do it.
I would say only when necessary. You know, like...
Swearing should feel transgressive for part of your life. It's not as satisfying if you... It's not as satisfying if you don't think it's bad at some point.
Yeah. I love to say fuck. Would you... Would you let your child get a tattoo? Yes, only after they move out. Absolutely not. Only after they've thought about it for a year. What?
Yeah, that's like a weird, like, you can drink, but, like, only if you do it in the house kind of bullshit. I'm going to say only after they move out.
Yeah, I think I'll say the same thing. Like, a child with a tattoo seems weird.
Yeah, I'm not going to be a... You gotta be an adult if you want to get tattoos. That's how I feel about it. Yeah.
You can get childish tattoos. Because,
like,
I have
to
pay for
the tattoo. Like, I'm not paying for my kid to get tattoos. Yeah, that's not happening.
Exactly. Lastly, what curfew will your kid have in high school? 10 p.m., midnight, no curfew. They live their own lives, 11 p.m. I guess they have school in the morning.
I guess it would depend on whether it's a school night or not.
Yeah.
We'll say generously that it's the weekend, and I'll say midnight.
I'm going to be even more generous and say they actually do live their own lives. They're their own human beings, and they're going to have no curfew.
I don't think you want to. I think you want to at least have somebody trying to sneak home after midnight, you know? Again, I think that you want to have these rules so that kids can break them sometimes.
Okay, but I want to be friends with my child.
I'm already a cool parent, so I can have some boundaries.
I'm also a cool parent, but I have fewer boundaries. You don't have to tell us. We already know your cool parent curfews. You don't believe in them. Bedtimes? Only for toddlers. I don't know about that. You're willing to meet your child halfway as long as the communication keeps flowing. And I was just telling you about how I did make a catio for my cat because she kept begging to go outside. So, compromise. It's important.
A couple of cool parents here.
That's right. Okay. Do you want to talk trade? Let's go to Trader Joe's. All that bad shit you eating is going to take a toll.
They got some healthy food for you and it's for the low. Let's talk Raiders.
Peter's voted it out. Which seems like stupid. It should have happened a long time ago, but...
I mean, it should have happened a long time ago, but it also should not have happened here.
Why do you say that?
Because there was not a reasonable case to be made for him, and there was a very reasonable case to be made for Phaedra, and to the point that MJ literally after being like, I just didn't think the evidence for Phaedra made sense, the second that one thing that someone said clicked for her, she was like, oh, it's Phaedra. It's like, you didn't think that at the time? Despite well, the no, fact that it's friends. Really obvious?
The Bravo click was super tight the whole time, and they wouldn't turn on each other. Now it's too late.
This is the thing that, like, why are you playing this game? Why are you playing the traitors?
I don't know. Like, did they explain what this game is to these people? I want Sandra to be a traitor.
You can't treat this game like, well, this person wouldn't lie to me. It's like, the whole point of this game is that if you are a traitor, you have to lie to people.
Yeah. You think if nobody's lying to you, then somebody's lying to you, you know?
It's bizarre watching people play this game where they think it's like... Like, do you think people are actually being murdered? Like, what? It's like, it's a game.
I haven't seen them in a minute. They must have been really murdered.
It doesn't matter how fucking honest you think this person is outside of the game. They're playing the game where some of the players have to lie.
I don't think the gameplay has been very good this last half of the season.
I don't either.
Because then fucking John is murdered. Why would you murder John?
Yeah, this felt... I feel like you're getting close to the end, so I get they want to get, like, a certain click out. I think it was a tough spot. I don't think there was really anybody that Phaedra could kill that would make a ton of sense, but, like, I guess the one way that you would maybe do it is, like, kill off your closest allies and then be like, oh, I wouldn't do that, but...
She should have voted off... she should have murdered Shreya. Get the scent off her, because John literally said, if I'm murdered, it's Phaedra. And then John was murdered. After Phaedra was the number one vote getter after the person who was voted out. Like, this is bad gameplay.
It was not good gameplay. But I don't know. I mean, I guess maybe, like, you've managed to get away with really obvious kills so far. Maybe she just thought she could get away with another one.
Sandra Kate's, wouldn't have done that.
Kate's not really helping there either, to be honest.
What is Kate doing as a traitor? Kate's I feel like she's doing nothing. Anything. But now it's only going to be on her. I wonder who she's going to go for. Something that is good, though. Alan wears a gold and black blazer, black turtleneck, and a black beret with a gold pin.
I love the beret. I think this is my favorite outfit of his for the entire season. This is
easily the best one of the season.
It's so good.
He was like, I see the final getting closer. It's time to... Stop it. CT says he feels like he's on a dating show now that he is the only man in the house and everyone is charmed by him. Of course. How can you not be?
This did kind of feel like a dating show. You know what dating show it felt like? Are you the one when people don't understand how to play the game?
Fair. Then they do a mission. They have to collect nuggets in a pile of dirt, and also Alan's dog is in a basket next to him. Pretty good shit.
They had to hop on some platforms also.
They also had to hop on some platforms. Thank you. Good shit. Felt like another challenge. So that's good.
Yeah, right down to what they were wearing. The outfits were very challenge. Like all black, but they had like a life vest on.
Right. Then we get to the round table. And finally, and I'm spelling that with a PH, Phaedra is banished. I don't know why this didn't happen sooner. Phaedra
Very stupid that Peter got voted off. I felt bad for him. Kate probably could have still flown under the radar, but she just had to say something bitchy, and I think she is absolutely going to get voted out as a result of it.
Yeah.
I think my favorite part of the whole episode was Sandra coming up to her at the end of that and being like, that thing you said about her playing selfishly, like fucking Columboing her.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah.
One more thing. Yeah. It's looking like Sandra's going in this thing. It's looking good. Real good for Sandra at this point. And
Sandra, it's looking like Sandra is going to win this despite doing basically nothing for the entire season. But you know what? You got to have a closer, and she's closing. Yeah.
But she, like, figured out the game day two and has, like, she's going to be able to get all these traitors out.
She's on cruise control.
Yeah.
I feel bad that Peter can't be there at the end, but Trishel has played a good game. I think CT has at least been flexible, which is good.
Yeah, so. That's CT's MO. He's always good at playing the middle. Yeah. Never promises anything to too many people. Never upsets too many people. Anymore. Back in the day, of course.
Yeah, not anymore. He used to do that. That's in his past.
He was like, oh, let me course correct. All right, Thomas, what's your blue sky?
You can follow me at tom.tom.bsky.social.
You can follow the show on Blue Sky Now, to onlyfunsurvivorpod.bsky.social, or on YouTube at the Only Fun Survivor Podcast. Thomas, what can people write on YouTube, the comments section?
Ha ha ha, very funny, smiley face.
Ha ha ha, very funny, smiley face. Last week we had somebody write, they need to work on the casting. They went woke, inclusivity over physicality. And then they do like a
no!
laughing face? What did they do?
Well, I didn't realize that Survivor had gone broke because they went woke, but
26 days. Why do you think that is? I'm giving this person a downvote.
Think about it. Yeah, that's not
what we told you to write. I've got problems
with casting. The diversity of the cast is not the problem.
Yeah, exactly. Like, yes, cast diverse people, but also continue to cast interesting people. Let's see, what was our last poll? I forgot. Okay. Our last poll said, would you have a beer with the Survivor 46 cast? And then I forgot to write the options. Wait, that's not true. I did write the options because I saw the votes earlier. Well, they didn't come through for some reason.
Who knows? What could have been with that poll? On to a new poll.
Okay.
I think okay. I have a very good one.
Okay, yeah, please give it to me.
Frasier or Cheers?
Ooh, that is the debate of the day, is it not? All right. Well, I think that's good. And I'm going to continue to watch Survivor and continue to plug the Patreon, patreon.com/justpodcast. Is there anything on there that you wanted to mention, Thomas Powell?
I think that we should definitely plug our new podcast, Did You Toss Salads and Scramble Eggs Last Night? And that one is, we'll say that one's $300,000 a month.
I think that's a reasonable price that anyone would pay. And that's...
And you know why they should pay that amount? Because I want to have a wonderful... what's the name of the cool armchair that...
A lazy that boy?
Frasier has. What?
I don't know. I didn't watch Frasier. The chairs in Cheers are called bar stools. I remembered my shit. Let's see if you remember your shit. This would be a fun segment on what's the show called?
What show?
Cheers versus Frasier. Feud. Cheers versus Frasier.
Oh yeah, that would be. I'm furiously Googling. It's an Eames lounge. That's what it is. It's an Eames chair.
Okay.
I Googled fancy armchair, and then I Googled fancy armchair mid-century modern, and then I Googled Frasier chair, and that got me what I needed.
You might think, why didn't I just start with Frasier chair?
Well, they could have meant his dad's chair.
Yeah, good point. Or Niles' chair, even.
Niles, okay. I guess Niles has, in his house with his wife, who's never shown on screen, he has like old fancy chairs.
Great bit. I love that in a sitcom.
You know what's really fun to say, by the way, is to say Niles the way that Frasier says Niles. You're like, Niles.
That is really fun. You know what else is fun? Writing a review on Apple Podcasts for 5 stars for this podcast called Did You Watch Survivor Last Night? If you have your telephone, pull up your telephone, and if you have Apple Podcasts, go on Apple Podcasts and write this review, Thomas.
This is my favorite podcast. I like it better than all the other podcasts. I give it a big thumbs up.
Well, and that's, of course, a 5-star review. Nobody's reviewed us in probably a million years, so thanks. 70-some degrees today, so you know what that means. Have a great summer.
Scrambled egg all over my face. What is a boy to deuces? All right. Yeah.
incredible stuff.
The jingle is unbelievable. Like, it wouldn't be anywhere near the cut to the cooler full of them. There's a few other ones like this that they did that you can see, like, they've been all over Twitter the last day or two, but like it wouldn't be anywhere near as funny if that jingle wasn't as good as it is, because it's such a fucking Cristo. Perfect
Cerveza Cristo.
That's very good.
Also, somebody in response to another tweet I saw was Chilean was talking. He's like, I'm glad that like people are getting to see this. He's like, it was really embarrassing at the time, but I guess with distance, it is pretty funny.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that apparently they also did it for Lost. So I hope that those clips surface, because I really, really want to see them.
I would love to see that.
You know what I bet they cut it into? I bet they cut it into when they like go up into the plane and they reach, you know, they get the maybe they're gonna break open one of the statues and then there's gonna be a Cerveza Cristo inside of it.
I was thinking you were gonna say when Jack gets the alcohol from the sky waitress. What do they call?
I'm not bailing Flight you out attendant. On this one. You can't say something that funny and have me bail you out of it. You gotta sit in this.
This one's called A Flight Attendant. When Jack gets the bottle from the flight attendant. I thought that's what you were gonna say. I thought they were gonna cut to a Cerveza.
It'd be so sick to be on a plane and be like, Sky Waitress? Hold up your finger.
Excuse me, Sky Waitress? I know that there's a song, right? By The Replacements called Sky Waitress or Waitress in the Sky, something like that. It's also funny.
They actually do have a song called
sexist.
Skyway too, so you could do Sky Waitress in the Sky.
Sky Waitress in the Sky. It's about a flight attendant who lives in Minneapolis.
Smarten up, Probst.